my name's Tripp Kuehne, graduate of Oklahoma State University. Got here a kind of roundabout way. I was a golfer, started at Arizona State, actually transferred into Oklahoma State to play golf, and really didn't know about the fine qualities of the business department, in particular kind of the finance department, the accounting departments, and all the great departments we have at the Spear School of Business. But came in, actually got my undergrad degree from the psychology department. I got an undergrad degree with a major in psychology, minor in business. Had 1 year to go with golf eligibility, so it was either turn professional, which I didn't really want to do, or enroll in the MBA program. So I enrolled in the MBA program, specialized in finance, and kind of changed the outlook on what I was always going to do, and I got into this great world of investing. When I got out of graduate school, immediately took a job at White Rock Capital, which was a long short, small cap hedge fund with some of the greatest investors in the world. George Soros was an investor of ours, Lewis Bacon, Caxton, so all the great hedge funds, the global macro hedge funds in the world were our investors. And I was lucky enough to be the sole analyst along with two general partners when a time where hedge funds weren't really in vogue. And we actually ran a different strategy. We were actually net short, where most guys are on the long side. So it was very important for us to understand, the fundamentals on what drove stock prices, whether it be accounting, whether it be options models, whatever it may be. But we really had to have intricate knowledge of the companies because we were so short. We could only make 100%, but we could lose an infinite amount of money. Whereas on the long side, you can only lose 100%, but you can make an infinite amount. So I started White Rock Capital, loved what we were doing. I one day wanted to have a firm of my own. Got approached by Kyle Bass, who was of subprime mortgage fame. He runs a fund today called Heyman Capital, but he approached me to help him open an institutional sales office for Legg Mason in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, where we covered regional long-only institutions and hedge funds out of New York, and that was going to be my primary responsibility. So I did that, got lucky enough to become very friendly with Stan Druckenmiller, who was famously broke the British pound, was at Soros Management for a long time, had his own firm, Duquesne, and been one of the all-time great investors. Kind of became my business mentor, and his guide guard and directed my career. So he introduced me to some of the greatest hedge fund managers in the world. I got to see how they manage portfolios, the questions they ask analysts, what they like and didn't like, reasons to buy and sell stocks, reason to buy and sell bonds or currencies or fixed income, whatever it may be. And I love the interaction with great managers. So upon doing that, I wasn't really a guy that was ever an ask for the order guy. I was always, maybe it's because of the game I played growing up, where you shot a score and it was either good enough or bad enough. I always came with ideas that were very deep in fundamental research that our analysts weren't really doing. 80% of our business was our own internal idea generation that we were giving out to our clients. And if they made money, they would pay us. If they didn't, if we didn't make money, then we spent a lot of time doing nothing. But I realized in the institutional sales portion of the business, when I was at a hedge fund, we were paying upwards to 20 cents a share for ideas. When I left Legg Mason, because the advent of, at that time, it was an instant machine where you could trade for a cent a share. Now you trade for a fraction of a cent, that you had to double your business every other year. And my ultimate goal really was always to run a fund of my own. I always thought it would be a hedge fund of my own, but because of the great contacts and the smart people I was able to meet, I started Double Eagle Capital in 2005. And it's been an incredible, incredible journey. We got the subprime mortgage aspect right. We survived the crash of 2008. We caught the rebound in 2009, and just kind of been grinded forward since then. And I attribute that to a couple things. One, the game that I played. Two, I was lucky enough that our now athletic director here at Oklahoma State was my golf coach, and instilled in me a lot of virtues that I still have today. And then just this university, being able to meet people, being in a smaller town where you're able to really go out and meet people, and it taught me the people skills necessary really to have a business of my own, to interact not only with underlying managers but also investors. unlike most, you know, managers of money, whether they be a mutual fund manager, a bond manager, or a hedge fund manager, what I have to do is I'm essentially managing allocations to other managers. So what I have to do is essentially sit in our chair and really do the macro research to what we think might be the drivers of economies, not only in the United States, but all over the world, 6 to 12 months in advance. So we can take advantage of a subprime mortgage opportunity, take advantage of, you know, the economic rebound and seeing that, you know, distressed or in a high yield is 800 over treasuries. And when that spreads 800 over treasuries, that's a phenomenal time to come in and buy distressed securities. So, you know, really trying to get out in front of where we think economies around the world are going and being able to find managers and allocate to managers that have scale, have operational stability, can take advantage of opportunities while not putting your money at undue risk to produce some outsized returns. So I find that's the hardest part of our business, but it's also the most fun because I'm getting to talk to, you know, the smartest guys to ever do it. That really took just a business of owning stocks and owning bonds and with the transformational people into this glorious business that is the hedge fund industry, a very controversial business that is the hedge fund industry. I mean, I've been tutored by and have investments with John Paulson, with David Tepper, with Stan Druckenmiller, Paul Jones, you know, Lewis Bacon, the all-time greats, you know, in the finance industry. And those are guys that I get to talk to, and I'm lucky enough to call those guys friends too. If you're considering, you know, the finance department, or you're considering a career in finance, it's important to have people skills. It's important to always use, you know, your connections and really figure out what sets you apart from everybody else. I was lucky enough that, you know, Stan Druckenmiller told me this, so I didn't come up with it. He said, "Tripp, you're not the smartest guy in the world. You're not the best looking guy in the world, but you are the best golfer I've ever met." And I was able to use that as an opportunity to open doors, because you never know what door is going to be opened because of a relationship. And if you're able to communicate and have a skill that you excel at, you know, the world can be your oyster. I mean, I'm living proof. I was, you know, an athlete that played golf, and because of the confidence I gained here at this school, I was able to go out and do great things and meet very, very influential people. And I'd follow that with do what you love, have a passion about it. If you have two guys of equal ability, and I can say this is why I didn't play golf, is if you have two guys of equal ability and one's living his dream and the other is not, the person living that dream and loving what they're doing is gonna be far more successful than the guy just going through the motions.